Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, the Mobile Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
Good evening. I'm Fred Friendly. This is Firing Line. I'm not Bill Buckley. Bill Buckley is not in this seat because he's in a seat over there and because he is one of the forensic four who are going to be debating part two of our debate begun last week, conducted at Bard College here on the Hudson River. Beautiful college, great place. Resolution is the feds should get out of higher education. As you might suspect, Mr. Buckley and his colleague, Professor Ernest van den Haag, who is the John M. Olin Professor of Jurisprudence and Public Policy at Fordham University, as you might suspect, they are on the side of the federal government getting out of education. They do leave that much crack in the door that there could be research and there could be loans as long as they get paid back. On the other side of this debate about federal aid to higher education, we have president of Yale University, A. Bartlett Giamatti, who is here tonight instead of watching the playoffs in the World Series, prior to the World Series. He is the president of Yale. He was not president of Yale when Mr. Buckley exploded Yale with of God and man at Yale, but as they tussle, you will sense some of the vibrations and echoes of that time. His fellow colleague, Leon Botstein, who is our host, president of Bard College, and also of Simon's Rock, which is affiliated. We're glad you're here. We're glad the audience is here. We're going to commence again. Mr. Buckley is taking his place at the podium, at the lectern. Mr. Giamatti, please begin.
Mr. Giamatti, in the first hour after I spoke, you began your rebuttal in a fit of utter exasperation. In which you said, here Mr. Buckley reaches all the way back to 1953. Given the fact that you spent most of your life studying the literature of the 17th century, what would be my complimentary reaction to your impatience at going back 350 years for your guidance?
I have no idea what your reaction would be, sir. I do know that the reason I thought it appropriate to take a view which is instinctive to me, which is in part the view that history brings us, is because I happen to think that the values and the structures of the past have a good deal to tell us.
Yeah, now, I found it interesting.
You object to the notion that values are encapsulated in the artifact?
Oh, no. I resent very much the absence of your reference to values in your talk. After you hurdled 1953, you then managed to go back 200 years. But in the course of doing so, in the course of stressing the historical role of America in education, You didn't bother to read what I thought were the most interesting parts of your speech on that subject as given in January of this year at the Avon dedication ceremony. You said, well, the first time any money was appropriated for a public school, it was appropriated because, quotes, it was decided that the ability to read and understand the principles of religion and the capital laws of the country should be stimulated. No comment. 3 years later, they extended those schools. Why, quote, it being one chief project of the old deluder, Satan, to keep men from the knowledge of the scriptures, it became necessary to have public schooling. Now, you know, and I know, and everybody in this room knows, that under the aegis of academic freedom, you're not permitted to take a pro-religious position, or even, so far as I know, a pro-moral position, because one can't define morality. So what is it that you reach back to tell us about the motivations 200 years ago of our forefathers?
You're bringing together in a fascinating fashion, sir. Of course. I would certainly hope it was not inadvertent the way you put that together. You quote a speech dedicating a library and a public school and the remarkable young researchers whom you must have working for you. Because I was citing the first laws in the Bay Colony in Massachusetts in 1647, which, in effect, founded public schooling at the grammar school level. Clearly, the culture of that time was a coherent one. There was a state church.
In contradistinction to our own.
In contradistinction to what's evolved over the last 300 or more years.
Okay, well,
can
we skip
then,
changed. Since this is my question period.
Mr. Buckley, but you've asked me a lot of questions, and you've made remarkable assertions, sir, and while I'm perfectly willing to wait until it's my turn,
I think, Mr. Buckley, you should let him answer the question.
I'm sorry.
You can't be fired from the firing line. I love Mr. Buckley, but I like this gavel better. Answer the question.
I hope I'm not keeping you all up. Is it all right if we go forward? Academic freedom, a term which has a specific content, and the inability to take a pro-moral or pro-value stance, as you said, have absolutely nothing to do with each other. If you want to talk about academic freedom, in terms that we could talk about, fine. If you want to assert that academic freedom is somehow a set of principles and procedures that are meant to deny the capacity to either to engage values or to have a moral view, then I would submit you simply didn't know what it meant.
I am saying that the doctrine under which schools were subsidized 200 years ago is excluded by the current understanding of the dictates of academic freedom, and in this respect, I cannot be contradicted. Now we move forward
certainly,
100 years.
You certainly
can
be.
We get to the Moral Act. The Moral Act, which was promulgated by Congress because, quote, religion, morality, and knowledge being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind, schools and the means of education shall therefore forever be encouraged. You can't say that. It's inconsistent with academic freedom. By the way, you said you volunteered to give us a legislative history of all of this. Can you give us legislative history of that Moral Act?
Briefly.
What?
The Moral Act's origins, even before 1862, derived from a whole set of policies where the desire to dispose of and to resolve competing claims about the disposition of federal lands resulted in, during the Civil War, in the federal government.
Want some help?
I don't want any help, Mr. Buckley, if it's going to be of the kind of information that we've already had pervade.
It was vetoed by President Buchanan on the grounds of its unconstitutionality.
Yes, and it was then passed
in 1859. It was passed during the Civil War.
It was passed by in a time of national emergency, when it was perfectly clear.
Why don't you let Mr. Giamatti answer your question?
It was passed the same year that they suspended habeas corpus. Go ahead.
Well, Mr. Buckley, I can't wean you from your habit of making marvelous alchemical connections that have almost nothing to do with the issue. The suspension of habeas corpus and the passage of the Moral Act are two wholly independent acts. There is, as I said to our friends at the outset, and I knew there would be, a radical distrust in your side of the whole process of education. That kind of comment simply exacerbates
these things. A radical distrust of what some educated people do and say. That's
well, correct. That is one of the hallmarks of being educated.
I have never feared an uneducated person. I've only feared educated people. I certainly wish Lenin had not been educated or Hitler. But anyway, Mr. Chairman, what I'm trying to say is that all the reasons that were advanced for measures which even then were controversial, which in the case of the Moral Act was even vetoed by the President of the United States, have absolutely lost their justification in terms of the modern dictates. Modern dictates says academic freedom does not permit you to pursue a moral course because we live in an age in which we cannot define morality.
Where does it say that?
It is presumptuous to attempt to do so.
Where does it say that, Mr. Buckley, and who has said it?
Well, it says that, that's certainly what I was taught at Yale University, and I don't know
I can't imagine that's what you were taught. Yeah.
Mr. Buckley, you can get your money back.
I don't know of anybody who would say that you could constitutionally get federal money these days on the grounds of a charter that said religion, morality, and knowledge being necessary to good government, etc., you all pay taxes. The answer is, you would say, why? Chief Justice Warren said we don't have to do that. And Chief Justice Warren's word prevails. Unhappily, you did not help to upset his position, notwithstanding your nostalgia for what happened 100 and 200 years ago.
Is that a question, sir?
You're terrible fix.
I'm sorry.
You spent a lot of time giving us the provenance of existing legislation, but the provenance is gone because the moral and historical basis for it are antipathetic to the conduct and the aegis of current higher education.
The only place where we differ fundamentally...
Just a moment, please.
Well, that's one of the...
You've got 8 minutes now, Mr. Giamatti, to work him over.
Well,
he has acted not only as your inquisitor, but as your tutor. Please do the same.
Well, I don't think, although I'll be happy to later, I don't think I'll pursue Mr. Buckley's line of questioning for him because I frankly don't think it would be productive and intellectually fruitful. You said that in your remarks or at the outset, I believe you said, and in 1976 or something, the government gave Yale $68 million in federal research money. Did you say that, sir?
Well, I took the figures from you. I assume they're correct.
Did you say that the government gave Yale $68 million?
Is gave the operative word?
The gave is one of the words we're going for, Mr. Okay. Biden.
I didn't mean to suggest that they sent Howard Hunt with a package.
I didn't think you meant to leave the impression that the university is given money by the federal government. You are, sir, I'm sure, aware of the way in which competitive grants for research are awarded through systems of peer review and so forth, that nobody gives anybody research money.
30% of your revenue came from the feds. Would you prefer it that way?
I'm not quarreling with the number. Mm-hmm. I haven't checked it, but I'm not going to quarrel with it.
You're quarreling with the notion that
it's
philanthropic.
I am quarreling with the implication that was left in the air, sir, that somehow this was a handout for nothing, that it was neither the result of competitive merit nor that there were any goods flowing from fundamental research that could inure to the benefit of the people in health, in science, in the humanities, which seem to be remarkably absent from any of your
Mr.
colleagues.
Mr. Giamatti, I don't, I'm sorry, I
have a second. Do you want to answer that?
If you intended me to imply that, I'm very sorry.
I certainly withdraw that.
If you dump $32 million over a crowded city from an airplane, some good would flow from it. Whether more or less than going to Yale, I just don't know.
It's a remarkable analogy that does you no end of credit. Do you, sir, clearly you have no real sense of the research processes, and I respect that kind of pride that you take in that ignorance. But what I am concerned about is that both you and Professor Vandenhaag, who's a very distinguished academic citizen and has been for some time, seem to think that there is a distinction between research and education. This was a distinction that was drawn by you, sir, I believe, and I wondered whether you shared what I would quarrel with as a curious view of the total educational.
Well, I share the position of the etymologist on the subject. The word education comes lead out of darkness, that's right.
Yes, sir.
And the word research means look into things unknown. So they are different words, which is perhaps why they occupy different holes in the dictionary.
Yes, I think we can all agree on that. But do you believe that the act of investigation, which is research in whatever field, is unconnected somehow to the act, the pedagogical act?
I think they're symbiotic. But I think that the distinction made by Mr. Vandenhaag was extremely to the point. That is to say, it is one thing to pay, as for instance in the scholars and all souls, don't even have to teach anybody.
No, that's absolutely
they just
true
research. So they cannot be involved in education in the sense we're here talking about tonight, are they?
No, they can't.
Okay.
But of course, we're not talking about them. The other thing that I was curious about in your remarks, and again, I'm not going to the issue of history versus today, You are, among other things, a novelist. I know that because I have read them, and I think they're fine. You are a distinguished writer, in my opinion, sir. Would you share your colleague's fastidious skepticism of what he delicately did not call the soft sciences of the humanities and the arts?
No, I don't think he would have used that word. I think he would attempt to distinguish, as you attempted to distinguish a moment ago, in the instrumental and non-instrumental purposes of government grants. It is one thing for the government to say, here is $1 million, here is a cyclotron, tell me how to protect Detroit from chemical gas. It is another thing to say, here's $10 billion, go out and find people to educate so you can educate more people.
Of course, no one says either of these things. So that I go back to the fundamental question, do you not believe that it is in the interests of the people of this country to have research, education, teaching, and fostering in the arts and the humanities and in values as much as in the so-called hard and scientific
pursuits? Mr. Giamatti, I'm going to be extremely stupid here by making a confession. Mm-hmm. I honestly think America is worse off than it was when far fewer people were, in fact, receiving a higher education. 52 out of 1,000 here. 40%. England is 10%, France is 11%, Germany is 13%, Japan is 18%. I don't see evidences either in Detroit or in Pittsburgh or in the Mellon Institute that we are that much better off.
Mr. Buckley, are you
seriously saying... So there's a disease raging in this country that the university is not coping with, and you've written a wonderful book on the subject.
Yes, I have. Sir, you aren't saying, I'm sure, to me, that you think American society, both in its structure, its governance, and its aspirations, is identical with those systems and countries that you've enumerated, do you?
No,
two
countries are alike.
Of course, that's marvelous. Do you wish to have some centralized system for determining who shouldn't go to college, Mr. Buckley, given the fact you think many people shouldn't? How would you decide that? I have a test.
How would you decide it?
Well, I'm asking the question.
All right, okay. Well, let's just use a rule of thumb here. Could we agree that the 30% of the American people who have never heard of the United Nations aren't ready to matriculate in higher education? If you will agree to that, then at least we've made some epistemological progress. Now, I'd like to know why four times as many people are equipped to get higher education in America as in England. Are they so dumb in England? Are they indifferent educated? How about France? France is doing very well.
I guess I don't share a kind of colonial's awe at the structures and intentions of European educational
processes.
I've got
no awe. I would have fought with the revolutionists.
I should have hoped so.
I definitely
on our side, I trust.
No, yes. There was only one side, the revolutionists. I don't like the elitist system by which people are selected to go to college.
Well, that's what I'm trying to get at.
I don't like it at all.
You don't like it a bit.
In the first place, it's totally statist.
Fine, exactly.
But here, you have a Republican myth that says because there isn't anything to do, irrespective of what you do when you're 18 or 19, you ought to go to college. Otherwise, you suffer a social stigma. And I think that is profane. Some of the brightest people I know have not gone to college. One doesn't need to college in order to be educated.
Mr. Buckley, you and I will never disagree on our radical and fundamental attachment to the principle that human merit will flourish given an opportunity. I think that's in some sense what you said. And I would assent to that wholly. The fact is, I don't want you to sound as if you think an education unimproves natural talent. And I can't imagine you're saying that if a person's ability will take them into an educational system whereby they can improve themselves and thus improve the life of their neighbors, that you would disagree.
There's no evidence of it.
Mr. Buckley, I love doing this. Thank you for that cross-examination. You could have a great tutorial session together. I don't think you meant to leave the impression that All Souls College was something that had anything to do with federal aid to education in the United States. We know that that's at Oxford, don't we? Professor Van den Haag, you have 6 minutes to support Mr. Buckley's position. Correction.
Time has been steadily reduced.
Thank you.
I just heard Mr. Giamatti once more say, and with great interest, I heard him say, that education is in the interests of the people, that it is a good thing. And I do wish to make it clear that I believe, as he does, that it often is. Not always, but often. But it doesn't seem to me to follow that it should be subsidized by the federal government. I think automobiles are good things. I think sex is a good thing. But I'm not in favor of subsidizing either by the federal government. The subsidy does not follow from its being a good thing. It follows only if it can be shown that that subsidy somehow improves the thing, makes it better than it would be, or more widely distributed, or more often produced usefully, than it would be if it were not subsidized. Now, at the present time, education is America's biggest industry, and higher education, which is a segment of it, is that segment which has grown fastest of all that industry. Now, we would therefore expect that people are either more cultivated, more civilized, or perhaps more productive. And here, let me point out, I don't wish to be accused of saying that education should have purely material results. Nonetheless, the statistics indicate that people who went to college tend to earn more than people who didn't. And it's not unreasonable to suppose that that is one of the motivations that people have to go to college. Now, unfortunately, though, even though we educate far more people than other countries do, and a far higher percentage of the college age group, our productivity does not equal that of other countries that educate so many fewer people. And I would suggest one cause for that. It used to be thought that a minimal IQ was required to benefit from college education. The IQ that used to be thought to be required was 110. 25% of the college age group has an IQ of 110 or more. 44% of that group, however, go to college, from which it would seem to follow that a very high percentage of people who go to college cannot benefit in any major way from the college education, which they get as a gift from the taxpayer. Wherefore, they often have indicated that they find that education irrelevant. And many colleges have indeed modified the education so as to make it relevant in ways, again, that courtesy prevents me from indicating in any detail. Naturally, if we waste, as we do, an enormous amount of resources in keeping people in college for 4 years under the impression that they learn there something useful to them, when they tend to attend college simply because it costs them very little. For instance, if you attend a public education, the cost to you covers about 13% of that education, the remaining 87% being paid by the taxpayer. If you attend a private institution, you pay about 1/3 of the total cost, the remainder being paid in various ways by government institutions, private industry, et cetera, et cetera. Well, it seems to me that if a great number of these people benefit very little from college education, no wonder that their productivity increases very little. I think the difficulty here arises because people confuse learning, which certainly, as President Giamatti has pointed out very incisively, is very useful. They confuse learning with schooling. They are under the impression that one necessarily learns more by going to college than by spending one's time otherwise. Now, that may be true for many people, those interested in abstract ideas, those interested in concepts, not necessarily for everybody. And I think it is foolish to give the impression, which the federal government has been supporting, that a college education is absolutely essential if you want to become a good citizen and a productive one. Which is why, I return to that, I have suggested that education should be paid for by colleges themselves, lending to their students what it takes to pay for their education. Since colleges would be the losers if these students don't do well, they would have a good reason not to lend to unpromising students. Since again, colleges would be the losers if they subsidize more students than are likely to be able to benefit from their education, they would not do so. And since colleges once more would be the losers if they subsidize students who take courses which are not likely to be profitable for them so that they can pay back what they bought, again, colleges would not do that. This, it seems to me, would do away with a major unfairness, which I mentioned before, namely that people who can never hope to earn as much as college graduates are compelled, as taxpayers, to pay for the educational expenses of people who will earn much more than they ever will. Let me conclude. It seems to me that government subsidies to higher education are unfair and unjust to taxpayers and favor the future rich over the future poor. Further, that they tend to reduce the productivity of the economy and of the individuals in it, and to create a class of ambitious, jobless, and embittered graduates. I conclude that subsidies for higher education lead to an immense waste of manpower and resources. Thank you.
Thank you. President Botstein, you have the enviable job of answering the team of Van der Haag, and Buckley.
I would like to go back to Bill Buckley's primary questions, and that is it necessary or is it wise for the federal government to be involved in higher education? But before I do so, I do want, for the benefit of all of us, to set aside several things which I think I would like to call into question. One is the patrician romantic sense of ignorance as being better than a miseducation. No one here wants to support the level of practice which American schooling and higher education is used to providing. We are in the front lines of those who would like that practice measurably to improve. But from that to argue that blissful ignorance in some kind of Rousseau-like sense of savage man's morality is in fact a superior state of being is, I think, an argument without purpose or not worthy of serious refutation. Furthermore, the notion that the IQ measurement, which is a very hotly debated idea, and whether or not it is in fact an accurate measure of one's capacity to learn, is a way of indicating what can be gained from a college education. I only remind Mr. Van den Haag of what a very distinguished classicist once told me when he was forbidden, and not a Jew, by the Nazis, to teach in a little village school to young people not on a university track during the Nazi era. They forbade him to teach any modern history or any modern subject. He taught instead Latin and Greek, chuckling that the Nazis would not realize only a modicum of those subjects had a better chance of fighting the disease of adherence to Nazism. So to measure the benefit of a serious prolonged education by such a dubious measurement as the IQ is, again, not worthy of serious debate. So to the issue. The issue are we better off? I would contend we are not only better off, but the counterfactual proposition, what would we be like if there were no federal aid, is quite a horrendous thing to imagine. The fact remains is that the amount of money, which is 2% of the federal budget, is not horrendous.
that what it pays primarily is to allow students to choose within a relatively free market between private and public colleges, among institutions, and to do so on the basis of merit, interest, and competence. That the federal government is essential for the kind of research function that is of the massive scale that modern science requires. That the economy and the national defense require not soldiers, as is today, who require manuals on the seventh grade level, but those that are able to operate the more and more sophisticated machinery of both war and peace. So I would submit that the educational establishment is deeply in need of more support. As to the relationship of research to education, this etymological discussion only proves one can only take out what one investigates and put in. Otherwise, one is reaching into an empty barrel. So it seems to me that there is no alternative. What is the alternative? Private philanthropy? Voluntarism? The notion of a supply-side philanthropy? Let's look at the facts. The facts are that the cost of even the most moderate estimate of what is a worthwhile system, we will concede, President Giamatti and I, the notion that we should have a British or an European system, perhaps. British have a private system, too. But even that system would require far greater subsidy than the $4.3 billion that is given in corporate support. 900,000 corporations make a profit, give no charity at all to any charity, and there is no reason to believe that the 2% or 5% rule will ever pertain. Therefore, there is not enough money, even in the most optimistic calculations, to fund even the most restrictive elitist system of research and education. Then, furthermore, I would say that even if we had such a system, we hear a lot about federal regulation. For those of us who ask money from private donors and private foundations, know what is from the federal government regulation that has some potential redress through the legislative and judicial mechanism is in the private side control and willfulness. That a foundation that wants to put in a chair for either Marxist economics or supply side economics, conservative economics, for the individual who wants to give you something in his inheritance or her inheritance that is not in your interest but in their interest, the kind of control that comes legitimately from private donations has to be compared to the evils of regulation. Both requires tempered criticism and a great deal of gratitude. But it seems to me that the counterfactual proposition, what would we do without it, seems to point that it is absolutely necessary to conduct the most minimal job in research and education for a nation that wishes to compete economically with other industrialized nations and wishes to defend itself against the Soviet Union, which is a system we do not envy, but has an educational system which should give us pause in terms of how we construct our national defense. Finally, I would point out, is it wise? Well, this goes to the heart of the question that Professor Vandenhaag has brought to us, and that is the moral improvement. I would like to inform that Hitler was not educated, either by a schooling point of view or by a more subtle definition of that term. And that is not to say that there is a correlation between education and moral behavior. Those of us who have studied the 20th century experience know that those correlations cannot be made. But it does remain that we are facing a nation that votes less and less in the national elections, whose capacity to follow the very torturous byways of legalisms and of the immensely complex system of government is more and more dim, that their capacity to follow the very complex international economical scene is even more dim. Their capacity to exercise proper judgment on the questions that face us is ever more a problem we need to respond to. We may not do it right. We may not have the answer. We may not educate effectively. The argument should not be a defense of improper practice. But the truth to us is now that to exercise a participatory system of government that vigilantly protects liberty, these are principles I think the National Review loves, and that individual initiative and all the virtues from which the original founding of this country was based, that job requires in the 20th century and in the 21st century a level of both technical and intellectual training for even people of moderate ability in order for them to redeem the notion that this is a government of people. And I would submit to the people who make the proposition whether it is wise for the federal government to be in education, I would suggest that without the federal government's investment and with a greater and more serious investment, we have no hope of improving the educational system. If we do not improve the educational system, we will have, as I agree with Mr. Buckley, people of enormous ignorance who do have the unfortunate gift of believing that they are educated because of diplomas on their walls, and we have done us a self-delusory disservice. But if we do not invest more through the taxpayers, who I think it is their will to invest more in this system, we cannot really hope of protecting the very system of government, the very marketplace of ideas, the very capacity to think for ourselves, and to defend technically and intellectually the very fabric of this nation.
Thank you. You see, I can use this against other people. Quiet! That's partiality to your president, and you penalize 25 yards. In the remaining moments of this debate, we have four serious and distinguished writers about education in the United States who can now, and invited now, to ask questions. We began this in the first hour. We continue it now with Richard Brookhiser of National Review, please.
Thank you. I have a question for President Botstein.
Would you please go to the stockade, the stocks?
I'll go to bat against the hometown boy here. Mr. President, you said tonight and also last week that federal aid to higher education was necessary to provide a system that was essential to our democracy, but I'm not at all convinced that you're willing to practice democracy and all its implications. Once something enters the realm of politics, it's in an arena with a lot of other ideas and a lot of other concepts, and it's once you put it in there, you can't take it out. Once you have education in the federal realm, it's in there with national defense, it's in with concerns about racial equality, it's in with concerns about political principle. And we've seen how these things have impinged. We've seen how in the 50s they wanted loyalty oaths from people in colleges who worked on military projects. We've seen how...
Mr. Brookhiser, the question, please.
Well, the question is, it's all very well to say that these things have to be watched and that they have to be regulated, but you don't have any standard, do you, for drawing a line? Why should academic freedom, why should education be uniquely privileged in the political realm?
It seems to me the reason that it should be uniquely privileged is because of the protections offered in the Constitution, primarily the First Amendment and the Bill of Rights. I, as a taxpayer, my taxes may go to national defense and to education. Insofar as the federal government behaves by giving, among other things, to me as a representative institution or to my children as students, dollars, we also have the right of taxation by the governed, that is, the consent that goes before taxation, the notion of representation. Therefore, in the Constitution, the protection where I'm able to draw the line is, in fact, if the attempt at federal regulation impinges as rights which are absolutely mine and protected by the Constitution against any prerogatives of government. So I'm in exactly the same position as you are to fighting the various prerogatives of government, whether they be eminent domain, whether they be the abuse by the President of the United States of claims to national security, any of the abuses that people invested with power may do. We have the same right as a corporate entity and as individuals to protect ourselves against the abuse of the federal government that comes with money.
Well, you're going to win some and you're going to lose some because the 14th Amendment is also in the Constitution, and that is interpreted these days as mandating affirmative action. And that means that the feds can come in because of their money and say you have to hire so many more teachers or you have to have different admissions policies and so on and so on.
By your definition of affirmative action, there might be a glimmer of a problem. My understanding of affirmative action, I welcome
the
14th Amendment.
Definition of the affirmative
yes,
action.
Yes, I happen
mine.
To have no difficulty with their definition.
Mr. Buckley, at some future firing line, we'll have to re-discuss and re-argue the Bakke case, which we're getting close to in the 14th Amendment. I carry around in my pocket just for occasions like this, but I think we have to move on. Mr. Williams, Dennis Williams is the education editor of Newsweek magazine. Who's your victim, sir?
Mr. Van Den Haag.
Please, sir.
Sir, would you say that it is all right for the federal government to, let's say, advance money for the education of someone who is not rich as long as that person intends to become rich?
I
I think his intentions would be quite irrelevant. If he, however, is willing to obligate himself to pay it back, then I think it would be quite legitimate to lend him money.
Well, that seems to me to be precisely the point of the Federal Guaranteed Student Loan Program. In the earlier hour, you said you used the example of someone who would become a doctor, which would be for the public good, and would presumably command a large salary that would enable he or she to repay the loan. What about someone who bears the same cost of medical education, but instead of going into private practice, goes into medical research, also for the public good, or chooses to become, say, a scientist or a school teacher, also for the public good?
I don't think that people choose to be school teachers for the public good. There's no evidence for that.
They choose to become school teachers for their financial reward.
Who knows why? I have never investigated that problem, and I don't want to. But it seems to me that if you have obligated yourself to pay back a certain sum of money, you must so arrange your future that you can pay back that sum of money. Now, it seems to me that if you become a scientist, say a medical scientist and so on, you can easily do so. In other cases, you cannot. I have no idea. But if you borrow, it seems to me that I'm not extraordinarily much of a moralist if I say then you have to pay back. And my point was, as you correctly noted, that I do not wish the federal government to make gifts of other people's money to students, but merely to use it to lend it to them if they want to borrow it.
Sorry, thank you.
May I follow up on that?
Have you got a quick subsequent question?
Well, I just wanted to ask that without the federal subsidy, it's included in the Guaranteed Student Loan Program, people would find it even more of a burden to repay loans if they went into less than the highest paying fields. And we already see that happening. If they were strictly dependent on free market loans, fewer people would go into less than the higher paying fields.
The highest paying fields are those, obviously, in which society is willing to pay the most money because it values these services most. And I'm all in favor, and that is a part of our economic system, people going into the highest paying fields, which is what they usually
do. Don't you think that the common good would necessitate the fact that, based on the free market, which would say that an engineer or perhaps an accountant is more highly valued than a school teacher. But don't you think that we, the people, have the right to have some say in that we believe that we need people in other professions, too, professions
sure.
Where you don't necessarily make $50,000?
Sure, if you value school teachers more highly, pay them more. If you value engineers more highly, pay them more. That's up to you. And the market seems to feel, and let me point out, at the present rate at which school teachers are paid, there's a surplus. And at the present rate at which engineers are paid, there's a shortage. It seems to me that, contrary to your valuation, which seems rather romantic, society does value school teachers enough to pay them more than is required to get the necessary number of teachers. Unfortunately, you get that number in English, in social studies, whatever that may mean, and so on, and you do not get the required number in mathematics and engineering and physics and so on. And that is
because they can't pay off the loans when they do that.
Did he answer your question, Mr. Williams?
That'll do.
Thank you. We are now in the last 12 minutes of this debate. The Fed should get out of higher education. Your last time at bat, President Giamatti of Yale. You have 6 minutes.
Would someone tell me when I'm approaching the end of that blessed zone?
I'll give you a slight tap.
Thank you very much. Throughout our history, we have entertained, usually simultaneously, a vast array of notions about education. It's been thought of rightly as a process to instill a cohesive devotion to what Jefferson called a due degree of liberty, to fulfill individual potential of mind and spirit, to inculcate community values, and to transmit culture. It has also been viewed as the royal road to social contacts or social respectability or social success, as necessary to a good job or to a presentable marriage, as sometimes something between a right and a luxury, somewhere between voting and boating. It is often spoken because conceived of as a consumer staple or a perishable but necessary appliance. Lately, we've learned to extol it as an investment, as if it were a municipal bond or a home. Americans believe education is good for you, young and old alike, though there is a persistent strain in American culture, of which we've had a remarkable example this evening, that believes that a little goes a very long way, and a lot is the result of not being able to do anything. We talk about it constantly. We see it everywhere, and we have developed a 300-year-old habit, also exemplified tonight, in the best sense, of wrapping our political wolves in educational sheepskin. There has been a federal role in education in America and has existed from the beginnings of the Republic. At times it has been oblique or hesitant, at other times direct and forceful. While it is true that education has often been the side effect of some federal policy, it is also, or federal act, it has also rarely, if ever, been the unintended side effect of federal policy. The federal role has been most direct in times of national emergency, as I said before, war, depression, or a period of reconstruction. At the first moment of national composition, and those later times when we need it as we do now to recompose ourselves, schools and the means of education were and are the glass through which the people and their national representatives most powerfully focus America's needs. Now, this has been the basic argument that we tried to present tonight. Not that the past will always live in the present, not that the present is a model for all behavior, activity, and standards for all time, but rather that there is something that is not necessarily constitutionally mandated, that is not necessarily written into every federal, local, or state statute, but which is rather an instinct for excellence, an aspiration for something better for yourself and the people for whom you care, your children, your parents, your neighbors, the people whom you think of with the same ties that you have for them, that education has both fostered and nourished. We've heard tonight a great deal of objection to the view that has been presented by my distinguished and excellent colleague and myself, and we have heard many surges to proof. We've heard talk about IQ levels, and we've been treated to a marvelous display of 19th century positivism as if that were meant to deny the fact that education is better for you and ought to make you better. We have heard no surge to excellence. We have heard doubts expressed because of the absence of statistical proof that somehow education is making us better, but there's been no serious doubt that education has historically in Western culture and indeed in world culture been viewed as a means of making one and making a people better, healthier, more responsible, more instinctively civilized in caring for other people. There's no serious doubt to that, despite the brave show of statistics. We've also been challenged to say, well, what would you have us do? And I have a very simple answer to it. I said it at the outset, and it was alleged that I hadn't said it, so I'll say it again, and I hope this time that I make it clear. The Secretary of Education, Mr. Bell, at the request of the President of the United States, has made a proposal dated August 1981 for a federal or national foundation on education. Secretary Bell lists as among the priorities of that national effort and foundation the nourishment and protection of equal opportunity, not statistical parity of outcome, but equal opportunity, the encouragement to education on the part of the needy, financial aid for those who need it, the fostering of research, health, space, all the areas of science and indeed the areas of the arts, and finally, the assistance to the state and local level to foster their own educational efforts. That's a program. It's a program that was requested by the current administration and has alas languished. I commend this program to those who find themselves much closer than I do to the current scene in Washington. It's an intelligent and responsible program. Its priorities are sound. It recognizes that finally an educated citizenry is still one of America's, and maybe America's, best hope to cherish the freedom that we love. Thank you.
Mr. Mr. Buckley, I'm sure that that applause for President Giamatti will not intimidate you.
Mr. Chairman, I had hoped that we would get through the evening without being pitted against education, but the odds were always slight. And indeed, all of a sudden, we find people like him who has two PhDs, like him who was a graduate student at age 23, like him who never had a grade lower than A at Yale University, pitted against education. It isn't quite clear to me why this is so. It occurs to me that since the name of Albert J. Nock was dropped here a moment ago, I think, without qualification, refer to him as the most learned man I have ever known, a graduate of this institution. He was not a very good man. He took the cloth, then at some point he left his wife and his two children, and he lived more or less sybaritically for the rest of his life off the indulgences of two old ladies, so to speak, his federal government. He wrote seven or eight exquisite books. He could write in seven or eight languages. Perhaps his most stirring book was called Our Enemy, the State, in which he has an essay which I once republished in one of my books called An Anarchist's Progress. The notion that that distinguished institution would condone the superstitions we have heard here ventilated by the gentleman over there, that the more education you have, the better off a society is, would have caused him to laugh, but rather alarmedly to laugh, because what he was concerned with is, of course, excellence, and the relationship between excellence and education is not one concerning which one can build architectural corollaries. We very much favor education. We don't know why it is that these gentlemen find so irrelevant the warnings of college presidents who were exercising their responsibilities as recently as 20 years ago, way back in 1953, as Professor Giamatti likes to put it. They warned us of what was going to happen. The presidents of Harvard, of Columbia, of MIT, of Stanford, of California Institute, they warned us that if we permitted the budget to go past $500 million, things would eventuate, which in fact have eventuated, which have caused complaints underwritten by most officials of higher education against the intrusions of the federal government. Why are these warnings not taken seriously? They're not taken seriously, unhappily, because people have a vested interest in just a lot of education. Mr. Giamatti most stirringly said in his penultimate speech that the federal government has, throughout the history of the United States, come to the rescue of historical circumstance. There is a sense in which it is true. But it is also true that the moment has come, as it often does, when the most patriotic thing that a federal government can do is to retire from that appetite on which it continues to feed. It was the government that we fought against in 1776. It was the government that we fought against every time we marched in and declared unconstitutional one of their acts of aggression. It was Cincinnatus who taught us to lay down his plow. What is it that we mean by calling for general disarmament if it is not that, in fact, we think government has gone too far in its capacity to kill whole lots of people? During the Second World War, we were paying in America a tax of 29% of the gross national product. That's when all of us were mobilized. That's when I was earning $50 a month as a soldier in the infantry in return for this GI Bill that Mr. Giamatti says I so munificently received after that service. Now we're paying 39%. We're not even at war. My point is very simply this, that at certain moments in history, you recognize what it is that you have to fear. The state, wrote Albert J. Nock, is the enemy of all well-disposed, decent, and industrious men. The state has tentacles, and in the name of this inchoate public out there, the taxpayers, who have never been identified by either of these gentlemen, because as far as they're concerned, they don't exist, that state seeks the freedoms that American people have, which they get primarily by regulation and by taxation. It is our point that precisely that national crisis we face is the crisis of assuming that the government has only to spend money in order to elevate the moral and intellectual insights. It is as much nonsense now as when we fought against the presumptions of the British Crown in 1776, if I can go back that far.
We are at the end of our 2 hours. 1 hour broadcast last week, another this week. The resolution has been the feds should get out of higher education. On behalf of the chair, which I'm only temporarily occupying, I should like to thank President Giamatti for coming all the way from New Haven to Bard. I really do have to say that the dialogue between you and Mr. Buckley was like slings and arrows back and forth, like Churchill and Chamberlain. Could have gone on. We could have danced
Churchill
all night.
Churchill and Chamberlain.
We could have danced all night. I want to thank you, President Botstein, for letting us come here to Bard College. You've been great hosts, all of you, your colleagues, Higgs here. I don't know where they stand on this issue. They have been so nonpartisan, but we like it here. We hope you'll invite Mr. Buckley back again. He makes the juices flow. And that's what a good teacher does. Professor Vandenhaag, thank you for coming. We learned a lot from you. And I'm glad you don't want to subsidize sex or automobiles. I hope you're still willing to subsidize just a little bit newspapers and magazines like the National Review. You know, Mr. Buckley, that I had... They wouldn't take it. Mr. Buckley, I don't know why you asked me to do this. I guess you asked 10 people and they all said no. I said yes. I had a fine time. I got a cue in my ear to keep talking, and that's easy for me. We're almost over, and now I hope this dialogue will go on in your homes, because it was only begun here. And Mr. Buckley, I want to hand you back this gavel.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night to you all. Thank you.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, the Mobile Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. For a printed-bound transcript of this two-part program, send $3 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the programs and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.